I'd like to tell you the story of Rose Olives. I'm sure that that name is a pseudonym, and I don't think it really matters whether we know her identity or not, to be honest with you, and you'll understand why as I share with you the interactions that I had with Rose. I think that's probably her first name. Rose sent me this message about a month ago via my YouTube channel. Hi, my name is Rose. You might remember me, but I'm not sure. We talked on the phone once. I've lost your number and email because I forgot to save it. Anyway, I am writing you because you're the only one that seems to care a little more than all the rest. I've recently unsubscribed from many channels and pretty much stopped watching many apostate videos. Now, I'm going to pause for a moment. First of all, I've spoken to so many folks over the last, 4 or 5 years since I got out, woke up, that it's true. Sometimes I can't remember or keep track of, of all of them. So I think I do remember. I was standing on my balcony a couple years ago, and she was having a crisis, and we talked on the phone because I think she had been disfellowshipped. That's my recollection. So she starts out talking about how I'm the only one that seems to care a little more than all the rest. Well, look, that's a sweet thing to say, and it's true. I do care. But, there's a lot of people out there that care. And I guess we all care in our own way, if that makes sense. Barb Sinclair, she cares. Mike and Kim, they care. Only in Christ, what a fantastic YouTuber he is. He has spent thousands of hours getting out tat. He cares. Londo Malari, lovely friend of mine. He cares. Great YouTuber, tat activist. Cedars, he cares. Had a fantastic conversation with him on Skype the other day. I'm driving down the road, looking at the ocean, and I'm Skype conversating with him all the way in Croatia. Just amazing. Technology is grand. I'm getting off the track. So there's a lot of people that care. Barbara Anderson cares. The amazing, XJWs that have blazed a path for us all the way back to Schnell with 30 years of Watchtower Slave. There's a lot of folks that have gotten out of the cult that care. Anyhow, Rose says, I've unsubscribed from many channels and pretty much stopped watching many apostate videos. Your channel and a couple of others are the only ones that I am still subscribed to. I notice that the majority of apostates are very uncaring, cliquish, and even discriminate against those who they perceived as different. I recently raised this issue on the comments section of one of these apostates' video and was very viciously verbally attacked. I noticed that the only time anyone paid any attention is if I became confrontational. If I had any sincere questions or concerns, I was totally ignored. She's probably telling the truth as she sees it. Part of it is that sometimes folks are just busy. They put something up on YouTube, they speak their piece, and then they go on about their business, and sometimes they just, we don't even see these messages, or we don't have the mental energy to, to engage or address every one of them or whatever. But this story isn't about me or other YouTubers. It's about Rose Olives. That's her name on YouTube. And she feels ignored. She says, I was emailing back and forth with this particular couple. At first, they were nice. I told them my story and had a few questions. They answered most of them. However, if I had any deep questions, they wouldn't answer. I think that because I wasn't vulgar, loud, or making videos to trash the witnesses, then I became unpopular. Oh yeah, Mark and Cora, they care. God, they care. They're so awesome, those people. I know, my mind's all over the place today. It's about Rose. Let's get back to Rose's story. Then I saw them totally adopt and befriend this obnoxious guy. It's weird, but I actually think I remember this couple from a congregation that I used to attend. I vaguely remember the sister not being very well liked. I don't know. I think the XJW community has a serious problem of being cliquish and discriminative against certain people. It's ironic that Jehovah's Witnesses are accused of shunning, yet XJWs do exactly the same if they don't like someone. Do you remember a guy named Jesse Lopez? How could I forget Jesse Lopez? Jesse, if you're listening, I want you to know, bro, I care about you and a lot of other people do. And just because I can't respond to all your messages or your videos that are directed directly towards me doesn't mean I don't care, bro. But you know what? We all got our issues. We all got our struggles, right? That's why I called myself Struggle. That's why my interview show is called The Struggle, because it's a struggle. All right, back to Jesse. He told me he was being discriminated and shunned by XJWs. I feel that he has some mental issues. Well, many of us do, but it doesn't make us bad people. It doesn't make us less of a person, and we all have a soul that matters just as much as everybody else's soul. I truly believe that. Anyways, recently I saw that he made a bunch of weird videos, but I think this is the result of his being shunned by JWs. I was communicating with him through YouTube. I feel bad for him. However, I haven't heard from him in a while, nor have I seen him make any more videos. I've had this feeling that he might be suicidal. Way to go to the XJW community by treating somebody so badly just because they're different. I personally feel very turned off by most of it. In fact, I began recently studying again with Jehovah's Witnesses. So that blew my mind when I read that part of the message. Remember, this is a month ago I got this. She says, this kind of behavior on the part of many apostates, especially the very angry, aggressive ones, can make people actually either go back or want to find out more about the Witnesses. Bo Jewell, he cares. Joel the Unwitness, he cares too. I see the good in all these people. But yeah, we all have our flaws. It's true. So this kind of behavior on the part of many apostates can make people actually go back or want to find out more about the Witnesses. At least the sisters that come to give me the Bible study do not verbally attack me. No, of course, they love bomb you. They love you, and they want to save you and give you a pet panda. I have been very upset over all of this. I would really appreciate if you could make a video stressing the importance of being supportive of all XJW individuals, and not just the ones that think they are cool or the ones that look or think like themselves. I think people would listen to you because they respect your opinion. I hope you reply to this message. Thank you for your help and support, Eric. Sincerely, Rose. Now, this is not the end of the story. Oh my goodness, by any means. This is kind of the beginning of the story, and this is going to be a little bit of a longer email share than some of my other ones because it just goes on and on and on and on and on, as you'll see in a minute. Before I read the next set of correspondences that I had with Rose Olives, I'd like to make a comment here. People go back to the Witnesses. People get turned off by, people disagreeing. You know, Mike and Kim and Cedars had a fight. And Tony Prime and Joel the Unwitness, who both of those guys I think are cool dudes and they're hilarious. They had a beef, and they jumped on one side, and other people jump on the other side. You know what? We're all on the same side, whether we think or choose to believe we are or not. We're all on the side of freedom. We're all on the side of individuality and expression and the beauty of life and living it without being controlled, without being told how to think, deceived, etc. And we all carry this newfound freedom out in different ways. And yeah, sometimes we fight and we argue. So what? You know what? We just got to get over it. And if, look, if somebody's feud on YouTube or on Facebook or online bothers you, then some of them have bothered me. You know what? Go outside and walk on a trail. Go to a body of water and just sit there and you know, meditate or you know, take beautiful deep breaths and feed the ducks or you know, listen to the surf roll in and out if you're lucky enough to live close to an ocean. These are things that I've done and I do and lots of people do. And you know, we can do something else. And we can choose to direct our lives and our energies in positive ways. Pick and choose what encourages you. That's all we got to do. You know what? Let people fight it out, whatever. One person says somebody's mentally unbalanced, another person's worried about another person, and you know what? We can participate as much or as little in all that as we want. It doesn't change the fact that we have freedom. And that's beautiful. And that we've escaped the cult. The cult of Watchtower. All right, so what I did was I responded back to Rose. I said, "Hello, Rose!" Exclamation point. I like to start out that way because it's just, you know, it's me. You know, I'm enthused to interact with somebody, and that's what I said. "Hello, Rose. Let's chat." And I sent her my text number. So we started to text. Now I'm going to have to hop over to a different app to bring those up because the text conversation that we had back and forth, I think it might surprise you. It certainly surprised me. I spent a lot of time texting Rose. Okay. "Hello, Eric, this is Rose," she texted me, December the 3rd. "How are you doing? What's on your mind?" All right, let's get through pleasantries. She said, "I guess I can't find any answers to anything that has to do with God." You know, look, that's very understandable because when you leave a religious cult, your belief system has been knocked down. You know, just like if you ever built something out of Tinker Toys or Lincoln Logs or Legos. I know I'm dating myself there, aren't I? I used to have an Erector set. Do you remember those guys? And those of you, most of you probably boys that got those. Man, that was fun. My dad helped me build stuff. I made like a Ferris wheel one time. Anyways, I am in a get off the track mood today, so you're gonna have to forgive me. I know some of you like it. As you go about your day and you listen to these videos, you know, it can be calming. It can be food for the mind. We can chew and ruminate on the parts that resonate with us. So yeah, Rose says, "I guess I can't find any answers to anything that has to do with God." Okay, I responded back. "I understand. You know it's okay to not have those answers, right? Question mark. It's okay not to have all the answers because we think that we have to have all the answers, or pardon me, we thought that we knew everything. We had them all. And it's very look, fundamentalist religions, intellectual cults, religious cults, they think they have all the answers. ISIS thinks they have all the answers. Kill the infidels. That's the answer for them. You know, everybody's going to die at Armageddon except the people that worship Jehovah. That's the witness's answer to everything, pretty much. Listen to the GB, read the WT, follow the program. Scientologies. Scientologists think they have all the answers. They're going to clean up the earth. They're going to save the planet. Did you know Scientologists believe that too? Yeah. Read Leah Remini's book, Troublemaker. I'm still going through it, still taking notes on it. I am going to do a video on that, and then I'm going to try and interview Leah. We'll see. Maybe it'll happen. Maybe Leah will be on The Struggle. I'm digressing again. I said, I understand, you know it's okay to not have those answers, right? And then I said, tell me more. Or if you wish to call me, it might be quicker that way. She says, no, it's fine. I'll text like this. She says, I'm working out, so you can take as long as you want to answer me. I guess I'm so desperate to find an answer of exactly who and what is God, that not getting any real answer has frustrated me to the point of maybe fighting or becoming hateful, I guess. I want to find something solid and supporting of people. I've had no success. Everyone is the same everywhere. There was a time, a long time ago, when things were different for me. ... All right. So, look, this lady is, she's suffering. She's confused. She's been tossed out like the trash. And she's not finding solace among the XJW community, at least the people on YouTube. But you know what? We find solace when we're talking to a friend face to face. We find solace when we're getting a hug, when we're giving someone a hug, when we help somebody. You see, this gets me emotional. But that's part of me. That's a big part of my makeup. I can be Mr. Spock for a few minutes, and then I'll go right back to being a big puddle. A puddle of love. So, we find comfort in helping others, in connecting with people, and connecting with beautiful animals and other souls. A dog, a cat, a bird, a rat. Yeah, lots of people have rats for pets. There's nothing wrong with that. I want to give a shout out to my girl Daphne. Daphne likes to have rats as pets, and she's a beautiful mind. And she's trapped. She's trapped in the cult right now. She's only 17 years old, and she has zero freedom. Ruled by the iron thumb of her rabid JW parents, who are not evil people. They're just captive to the concept. I love you, Daphne. Anyways, once again, let me try to get back on track here. Rose finished by saying that she's had no success. Everyone is the same. There were, you know, bad vis-a-vis. There was a time long ago when things were different for me. Well, look, when we're asleep in the cult, we're happy. Right? Sometimes we reach a point where we're happy for a little while. It's the honeymoon phase. And then as soon as the elders start getting in our business and telling us what to do, as soon as we start getting gossiped about and stepped on at the kingdom hell, well, then that's when we either start to numb ourselves with alcohol or whatever our secret habits end up becoming, or we just, stuff it down, squish it into a tiny little black hole inside of our mind, and it stays there, sometimes for a long time, sometimes for a couple of years before it surfaces. Well, it's surfacing with Rose because she's been tossed out like the trash, and now she's going back to the witnesses for more. I said, you sweet lady, I feel for you. When a person leaves the witnesses, there is a vacuum there. We are used to knowing everything. Now we are disillusioned, and we find that the things that we were so sure of are now uncertain. I definitely felt that way when I woke up to Tat. Everyone has personal opinions of who or what God is. These are things that develop over time. As time goes on, you read and think and research, and you will begin to develop your own truth. The J-Dubs want to say that only they have the truth. Scientologists want to say that only they have the truth, on and on and on, ad infinitum. Now we know that that is not the case. Now we know that there are many different truths, and one is not necessarily better than another. I have no doubt in my mind that you are a strong, intelligent woman. You are a human being. You are a spiritual person. You are a creator yourself, as we all are. You don't need anyone to give you answers. You have enough tools to figure these things out for yourself. And for the most part, it's usually better that way, that we come up with these truths and points that are salient to us, ourselves. What the Watchtower does is stunts our development, stunts our natural growth. They seek to create dependent people, dependent publishers that need elders and Watchtower magazines and Kingdom Ministries, which they got rid of, to tell them what to do and how to think. Now that that structure has been removed, now that you know the Emperor has no clothes, it can be scary. It's like performing without a net. Life without a net, so to speak. LOL. Okay, I sent Rose all that. That was a lot of texting, you know. And I hope that it helped her. I hope it's helping her right now. But as you'll see, Rose is, she's stuck in a loop. And you know what? For her, the J-Dubs is what she wants eventually. We're getting to that. I just gave something away. Oh, well. All right, her response. Yes, that's true. But every time I pray, the witnesses show up. It can't be a coincidence. It's happened too many times. Now I accepted a Bible study again. I want to relearn what I was taught as a child. I want to understand it exactly as they teach it. All right, so look, we've all heard those stories. It can't be a coincidence. I was about to, you know, I had a gun on the table, and then I heard a knock at the door, you know. What tends to happen is memory is very subjective. Memory is very malleable. We tend to remember things differently each time we access the memory. And there's some studies that indicate, and I read this in a science, I think it was Popular Science. They said that each time you access the memory, you change it a little bit. Because the way that the brain stores things is radically different from the way a computer stores it. The brain stores things across a million or a billion different connections in different places within the area that memory is here, memory is there. You can lose half your brain and still keep most of your memories. They don't understand it. It's fascinating. So this is the way she recalls it. And I believe that she remembers it this way. Do I think that there's some cosmic coincidence going on here, or that there's some, you know, Jehovah is maneuvering the Dubs, and the angel in mid-heaven is directing the Dubs to her every time? You know, I personally don't feel that it works that way. But she does, and that's okay. See, That's what's pulling her back to the witnesses. Okay, my response. It really isn't that hard. It really isn't that dangerous to live a normal life, LOL. To decide for ourselves if we want to celebrate Christmas or not. Personally, I think it's fun and enjoyable to give presents to the people I care about. I also love the smell of the tree and the little lights and the ornaments. I find it beautiful. I don't have the sentimentality attached to it, as I never celebrated it growing up. You know what? Actually, I did. When I was 1 year old and 2 year old, I celebrated Christmas. And I have a memory of that. I should maybe talk about that some other time. But I do have a memory of pushing one of those little poppers that they give toddlers on a stick. I had just learned how to walk. And I remember pushing it along. I was in a little red onesie, a little red zip-up suit. And I was pushing it along, and I remember seeing the tree at like worm's eye view, you know, that super low POV that they do sometimes in a show or a movie. I remember that. That's my earliest recollection. My mother maintained that I couldn't remember it. It was impossible that I remembered that. And I said, why? And she said, because you were only one. I said, I don't know. I think I remember it. But once again, sometimes we remember the memory of someone telling us about something and then we claim it as our own. That happens too. Very subjective. And I'm off the track again. Okay. Nevertheless, I have incorporated it into my life and my children's lives, and it's enjoyable. It's fun. I don't see anything wrong with it. You may have a different opinion, and that's okay. I hope that I'm making some sense. I personally believe that your experience with the witnesses calling on you is a coincidence. These people want to latch on to you, Rose, because they see you as an easy target. The individual publishers are sincere, and they're often nice people. But as a friend said, they are captives to a concept. Well, Ray Franz said it too, and he got it from someone else. He got it from a Catholic priest or monk that left the Catholic Church because it was a cult for him. They believe that the Watchtower is the only true religion, and then everyone else is false. And the origins of their religion show this to be the case. They believe that the Watchtower is the only true religion. And the origins of their religion show that this is not the case. The leaders do not really care about the members. They are like bugs to them. They are simply customers. They believe that the Watchtower is the only true religion. And then everyone else is false. They are simply customers. Rose says, yes, you are. Sadly, though, I still need answers. I want to know what the truth is. I don't want just a maybe or this or that. There has to be an undeniable truth out there. You see, and that's where we get this black and white thinking. Black and white thinking, in my mind, is a shortcut. It's an easy way to live your life. Everybody's either good or bad, right? Cedars is good or he's bad. Mike and Kim is good or she's bad. I'm good or I'm bad. I'm smart or I'm dumb. This is either true or false. Okay, here's my response. I did see arrogant behavior of several governing body members when I served at Bethel. I researched Ray Franz's book, Crisis of Conscience, in great deal, and virtually everything he wrote in there is true. Have you read it yet? She says, I started it. I haven't finished it, though. See, that's finish it. Finish it, Rose. She probably read 15 pages. Why do you think I'm an easy target? You see, I think I was being a little blunt when I said that, and she didn't like that. You know, who likes to be an easy target, right? P.T. Barnum said there was a sucker born every minute. And when we were in the witnesses, let's face it, we were suckers. When you were in Scientology or extreme Mormonism or extreme Seventh-day Adventism, fundamental Christianity, you know? We were all suckers. We were deceived. All right. My response, quote unquote, undeniable truth, is a loaded term to me personally. The witnesses target people that are lonely, out of work, disenfranchised, having problems or issues with their life. These are the primary people that come in on a Sunday morning as a new Bible study or interested one. I have seen this over and over and over again from one congregation to another that I belong to. It is a characteristic of what cults do. Look, Steve Hassan, in his excellent book about combating cult mind control, the Moonies got him in the same way. He was in a vulnerable period of his life. He was young and impressionable, just going to university. These people seemed so fresh and friendly and exciting. This big community that just wanted to wrap their warm arms around him in a blanket of friendship. That's what cults do. Okay, the Jehovah's Witness movement is a cult. It is undeniable. They fit all definitions of such. They all have similar characteristics, and one of them is to love bomb new members. Are you familiar with that term? And when I say easy target, Rose, I want you to understand I do not mean this towards you in a critical way or in a personal way, because I don't really know you. What I mean is there are groups that seek out people that are going through certain things in their life. Once the structure that buoys up and holds and props up a member is taken away, it can be traumatic. It can be very difficult to cope at first. And then, of course, that's what she's going through. And those of us that have left you know, this delusion that we were under when we were in the witnesses, we go through it. We follow that arc. I've talked about it, and lots of great people have talked about it. Compounding this is the fact that you have had difficulty forging connections with XJWs. People, though, are people. We are a former this or a former that. It doesn't really matter, in my opinion. What are your hobbies? What are your interests? I had a friend that had a lot of success going to meetup.com. He enjoyed astronomy and hiking. He found people in his area that were into those things. He ended up making a number of friendships and even went on one date that way, lol. It was a great experience for him and helped him as he got out of the movement. Please consider finishing Crisis of Conscience before you resume having a Bible study with these folks. Also, watch my judicial committee trial if you haven't already. This exposes the hypocrisy and the doublespeak of the group very nicely, in my opinion. JWFacts.com is a fabulous website for reference. Print off some of the info there. Show it to the ladies that are visiting you. Ask them questions. If they will speak in an intelligent manner about it, kudos to them. If they flee or denounce it as quote-unquote apostate, then we can see that they have no real truth to stand up to. May I ask you what you think at this point? See, because I'm sending her all this, you know, I'm trying to give her kind of a crash course in all of this stuff and give her a, you know, a frame of reference for what she's going through. She says, it's okay. It's weird that you're saying the same things one of my attackers said in one of the last videos I watched. I guess you're saying it in a nicer way, though, LOL, exclamation point. You know, I'm actually in a relationship, so I don't think I need meetup.com or whatever that is. I guess I was used to a different type of people in my own country. People here are not very accepting of those who are different from themselves. You are from here, so you probably don't understand what I'm talking about it. Other foreign people do see this behavior as well. I have sensed this type of behavior among XJWs as well. I often feel ignored, except for you. My frustration is not coming from loneliness, as I have friends among the JWs. They understand me and never say mean things like a lot of XJWs do. I see many XJWs very filled with resentment and just plain hatred. They would attack viciously if you're not in agreement. Or if, like I did, point out the fact that they are not supportive, that makes me question how right they really are. And then my response was, because she misunderstood, which, you know, it happens. We all do. Meetup.com is not a dating site. It is for finding platonic friendships with other folks that share similar interests. And if you're looking to connect with people face-to-face, it's a great place to go. If you like to knit, if you like to sew, if you like to windsurf, you know, if you like to cosplay, whatever you like to do, punch in your zip code and find people. It's about connecting with other people. I really believe that. I think that is one of the most therapeutic things that we could do. Anyways, I said, if you have friends that accept you for who you are, friends that accept you and love you unconditionally, then that is fantastic. Yes, some XJWs get angry, and many of them have a right to be. Decades of their life, in some cases nearly all their life, has been stolen from them in certain ways. Instead of enjoying ourselves and having normal recreation, etc., we have sacrificed countless hours and had ignorant ways of thinking, captive to this damaging religion. It makes people get angry when they get out because of that fact. Rose's response, honestly, the only place that I feel accepted is among the witnesses. Regardless, they are taught good things, like have love among yourselves, regardless of color, nationality, or any personality features that may be difficult to tolerate. They lovingly try to deal with people's imperfections without totally rejecting or attacking the person. And, you know, Rose is connecting with that. That is another characteristic of many of these cults. They do try real hard to accept you and bring you in. And it's a way that they gain Mick customers, Mick members in their McDonald's of religion.
My response? Unfortunately, that may not hold true when you disagree with their worldview, or if you say that you don't think it's wrong to be gay, or to vote, or to use your own conscience to decide if you want to celebrate your boyfriend's birthday. What does he think about the J-Dubs, by the way? Also, I wanted to mention that after I escaped, I went to a very nice non-denominational church and enjoyed it very much. I found there to be just as much love as there is in any kingdom hall that I had ever been to. They have lied to us about what other churches teach and believe, and what other religious people do. Perhaps that would be encouraging to you, to go to a non-judgmental church that just teaches basic Christianity. You will find the same good morals and good lessons, and most of the exact same scriptures will be read during their meetings, just like at a kingdom hall. They will ask for money less than you'll ever be asked for money by the witnesses, too. How ironic is that? Okay, Rose's response. It makes me wonder if the reason why apostates are so passionate, in an angry sort of way, is because somehow deep inside they know there's something wrong with the way they act and think. I wonder. Just going back to what you said before, I've seen very successful people accept a Bible study. So it's not only lonely, unemployed people. I do have a job, and in 1 year I will be graduating from college and getting my degree. I started researching YouTube because of the accusations and all the situations with JWs. I believe that this is a bad world and we need some serious change. To deny this fact is to be living in a fantasy world. There's so much suffering. The people that do not experience this kind of suffering think the world is wonderful. But it is only wonderful for them. These type of people can't see others suffering because they have no empathy and can't walk in someone else's shoes. Wow. Wow, that's all I can say about that. My response, valid points. I was speaking in a general sense, of course, regarding who is ensnared into Watchtower's religion. Many cults have intelligent people, professional people in them. Look at Scientology. Do you agree that the JW Watchtower religion is a cult? Her response, my boyfriend has no opinion. He thinks the witnesses have a decent faith, but he is also confused with the present issues. He and I both wonder what's going on. I want to think that Jehovah will soon intervene and clean his organization. But I think they might indeed be his people. I guess time will tell. Well, 150, 200 years has told us that the witnesses and Russell and Rutherford are not God's people. All you got to do is look at the proof in the pudding. That's just an opinion I'm throwing out there right now as I reread this lengthy story and discussion with Miss Rose Olives. My response, many of us that learn TAT want to believe that Jehovah is going to clean out his apostatized organization. I've heard people say that the governing body apostatized in 1990 when they chose to join the UN, 91 when it happened. Proof of fact. That's a thought. Mr. E. Watchman is big on that. And other splinter groups, anointed JWs, some sincere, lovely people there as well, that want to split off or be a faction that believes that God is using the witnesses. He just needs to clean them out, just like Jeremiah preached to his own people. And the E. Watchman guy thinks he's Jeremiah, etc. You know, that's a theory. I don't agree with it. You know, some people do, and that's okay. Okay, but all the way back to Russell, it has been a business for these people. There's a book called The Four Presidents of the Watchtower Society. It is an excellent read. It goes through Russell's tenure. It goes through Russell's tenure as a leader of Watchtower, then Rutherford's, then Franz's and Knorr's. Or Knorr's and Franz's. It's very illuminating. Every single one of these four men was in it for the money and the power. You know what? If you think Russell wasn't in it for the money and that he just gave up all his money, gave up all his clothing stores, he and his dad, you know, he just poured it all into a nonprofit, think again. Russell made an enormous amount of money selling the studies in the scriptures. Those seven books, he only wrote about half of them. Maria Russell, his wife, wrote the other half. Look it up or ask Barbara Anderson. Go to her excellent website, Watchtower Documents. You'll see. It's all there. If you know, if you're willing to dig for it and look at it in an unbiased way, it's all there. All right, her response. No, I don't think it's a cult. It's filled with very good people who are trying to be decent human beings, something I don't see in the world or among XJWs. You see, we don't see good people in other aspects of the world because we're not looking for them or we've never gotten to know them. The Unitarian folks, humanists, the Republicans, the Democrats, there's so many good groups of good people out there. You know, and we can agree to disagree. That is how civilized man functions. That is why society is getting better. You know what? We have less crime. In the last 20, 30 years, almost every single crime statistic has gone down. Not up, down. Anyway, I'm getting off the track again. I'm preaching. All right, she goes on. She says, the people that do wrong, pedophiles, do not represent the entire organization. The people that do wrong, pedophiles and their like, do not represent the entire organization. They are just bad apples. And the leaders will have to respond to Jehovah. These are all canned answers that the JWs use to excuse their activities. You know that, right? Look up the definition of a cult. Steve Hassan, an expert on the topic, author, public speaker, TV personality, has identified the major cults, and JWs are one of them. Her response, didn't Russell have money? I mean, wasn't he an independently wealthy guy? And Rutherford, wasn't he a judge? Forgive me if I'm mistaken, I might be, ... Read the book, Rose. I'm referring to The Four Presidents of the Watchtower Society. Great book. You can get it on Amazon. Unlike Crisis of Conscience, you can't get on Amazon, which is depressing. I digress. Yeah, let's not get into that feud either. Read the book. Read about his divorce trial. The transcripts are out there. Russell was a cad, and his wife Maria helped him write half of the books. Yet he tried to claim he was poor and could not give her any support money in court. The judge excoriated him in court back then. Yeah, it's right in the transcripts, and said that his conduct towards his ex-wife was shameful. He simply transferred his wealth to the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society. He still wrote the checks. He still drove around in luxury. He flew all over the world, rode in steamer ships, ate fine meals, sold products like Miracle Wheat and books through the pages of the Watchtower. And he increased his wealth quite a bit during the time that he ran the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society. It was a company and a religion. Also, Russell was a Mason. He believed in pyramidology. He also believed in phrenology, too. Phrenology is the nuttiest thing in the world. If you don't know what it is, just real quickly, they used to think it was all the rage back in the late 1800s, early 1900s, that they could read the bumps on your head and the shape of your cranium, and that would serve as a guide to your personality, a little bit like your horoscope, almost, were represented in the shape of your head and the bumps on your head. Now, I can tell you this. I fell off of about a 4-foot, I don't know what it was, a box that they would put like all the baseball equipment into. You know, I was out at a ball game. My dad was playing softball. Well, I fell right off of that 4-foot high box and hit my head directly on the concrete. And I got a mild concussion. You know, I was a kid. I don't know. It's probably 10 years old. But I have a permanent bump. I got a permanent little goose egg in this one spot on my head from that. So, I don't know. Rutherford was even worse. He was an alcoholic and a womanizer. We have documents and eyewitness accounts of his epic drinking and his cursing at Bethel. Yeah, that's the Olin Moyle court case. We have the transcripts from that as well. Did Jehovah use these fine fellows to give everyone their food at the proper time? It's laughable that he would. Rutherford was not a real judge, by the way. He was a lawyer. He did a hostile takeover of Watchtower after Russell died. He was not named president. He was one of about 15 members named on the board of directors. He cut out his opposers and bullied the others and made himself president. It took him about a year, I believe, for him to complete his hostile takeover of Watchtower Bible and Tract Society. I have old issues to back it up. It was a crazy time. He even got into a shoving match with one of the other board members that opposed him. He was a very tall and large man. But Rose, if you want to go back to the witnesses, and you want to enjoy the social and religious aspects of their club, then do so. I wish you well. I do not want there to be ill will here at all in our conversation. We can all get along. We just don't have to shun one another. All right, her response, I hear you. What about the Israelites? Do you not remember all the bad things they did? How about men that Jehovah chose to guide his people? Did some of them not commit serious offenses? Remember King David? Is he still not considered his faithful servant? Were the Israelites not considered his people after they sinned again and again, until Jehovah finally said, "Your house is left abandoned"? I believe that Jehovah will hopefully soon remove all the weeds from his organization. If he exists then, he must have a plan to help humanity. It only makes sense that this will be the case. I want to thank you for your time. I most likely need to quit watching all apostate material, as it has only served to upset me and to have people attack me. I leave with a clear impression that apostates are very resentful, whether justified or not, and so filled with hatred that they do not stop at nothing to tear a person apart. I have told the witnesses about all this already. Not once have they stopped talking to me, and I have not been horribly offended by them either. Have a nice day, Eric, and good luck in all your endeavors. All right, so look, she's obviously choosing to go with the Watchtower bullshit. You know, I said a cuss word, but it's to me, it's the only word that fits. I try really hard to use the right words or the words that, you know, that seem to be the proper words in whatever situation I'm using, and that's the word. So yeah, I mean, that's her viewpoint. And I felt good that, you know, even though I hadn't convinced her of anything and she wants to stay in the club and go back to the club, and, you know, that's okay. She needs it. Some people just need it. They need that structure. They need that crutch. And I don't say the word crutch in a pejorative way. I mean, look, if you have a broken leg or a gimped leg, it ain't your fault. You know, you need that third support. You need a crutch. Good luck in all your endeavors. I said good luck to you, Rose. I disagree with you on some things, but that is what makes civilized discourse and debate a good thing for society. Take care. All right, so I thought, I mean, and that was the end of it, right? We're done. Rose Olives, she gets tossed out of the witnesses. She comes back. She's weak for a long time. You know, she decides to start a Bible study up with them again. She's lonely. You know, she wants to know about God, and the witnesses have all these, you know, little Lunchable-like answers. Everything you tear the little saran top off, and they've got these little perfectly formed round slices of meat and these little crackers that go down so easily, right? The Lunchables of religion. That's a new one. So the witnesses have what she wants. She likes their Lunchables, you know, and that's okay. So I thought we were done. I thought we were done. So, like, I don't know, maybe the next day, I think it was, or maybe it was later the same day. Check this out. Now I got to hop back over to YouTube. I get another YouTube message from Rose. And she says, "I'm not going to continue to talk to you or ask you for any advice ever again. I thought mistakenly that you were a good person. However, I now feel very compelled to write you this last thought. I was very upset after I finished texting with you." Okay, now I'm going to pause her YouTube message to me, right? This is sort of like phase three. You know, phase one, she messages me. We talked a couple years ago. You helped me. That was when she first got DF'd. And she, in my recollection, she got reinstated, you know, just so she could, you know, reconnect with her adult child and some friends, you know, very common story there. Drifted away, disenfranchised, etc. So she called, I'm just recapping for my own benefit, maybe for yours too, because this is a long one, right? So she messages me on YouTube, wants my help, doesn't like the angry apostates, appreciates my kind and gentle responses and that I care or whatever. Yeah, sometimes I'm kind and gentle. Sometimes I'm not, right? We're all, that's the duplicity of our personalities. So then we do this lengthy text exchange, you know, and I put in a lot of effort because I wanted to help Rose Olives. And I, you know, that's just because that's what I did. I spent the time because I wanted to spend the time reasoning with her. Okay, it didn't work. We finished the texting conversation on an amicable note, right? She wants to go back to the witnesses. She sees good there. Jehovah's going to pull them weeds. He's going to tear out them weeds. Yeah, you got some big weeds to pull, you know, like thousands of pedophiles and cover-ups, hypocrisy, money-grabbing, but pull out them weeds. Of course, if Jehovah did pull out all the weeds in the Watchtower organization, there might be one or two letters left in Watchtower, but that would be it. All the other letters would be yanked out. You wouldn't have much left. Okay, now we finish amicably, and like later the same day, I get this angry YouTube message. Okay, she says, I feel very compelled to write you this last thought. I was very upset after I finished texting with you. I did not appreciate the comments you made about how the Jehovah's Witnesses choose unemployed, lonely people to preach to. While I am not unemployed, I do feel lonely. Oh boy, she's telling on herself. Okay. Now look, I'm not, even though Rose has issues and I disagree with her, I it's not right to belittle her opinion, even though it's kind of nutty right now to me. I did it again. All right, she goes on. It's not a sin or something that anyone has the right to use to offend another person. Now, I did not try to offend her, but obviously she was offended. Okay, that's her right to be offended. You do not know the reasons why a person might be lonely or what they might have gone through or might be going through. You sounded exactly the same as a person that verbally attacked me in a comment made in one of those other couples' videos. They made a mockery of the whole thing and gave each other high fives for the way they so cowardly attacked me. Now I'm even thinking that you are either that person or you read and agree with the insults I received. Okay, look, and I'm going to pause her message again, her diatribe again. I don't know what this other thread or is about. I never read it. I have no idea. So, you know, but now all of a sudden, I mean, it's almost like she's, you know, like I'm in on it, and I was toying with her. It was a game of cat and mouse or something, I guess is what, I mean, that's what she's inferring. Now I am thinking that you are that person, or you read and agree with the insults I received. It is a cruel thing to do to a person. Look, I got a lot of faults, but cruel? No, I'm not cruel. I would never, why would I do that? They have no idea of how much damage they did to me. But as cruel as they are, I am sure they would love to see that they are actually hurting my feelings, or that they actually hurt my feelings. And these are the people that are supposedly justified to be so angry? ? They turn around and do worse to someone else. If I sensed that a person was maybe lonely, I would not use that to attack or offend them. Much less would I sarcastically suggest that they go to a dating site, okay? Honey, I didn't suggest you go to a dating site. And I was certainly not sarcastic. Every text I sent you was sincere because... Look, if you can't be sincere when you interact with people, you know, go back out to that lake, that body of water, and, you know... And just think about it. You know, work on it. Be sincere. Be honest. Be genuine. You know, if you can. If you can. So she implies that I sarcastically suggest she go to a dating site. Oh my goodness, meetup.com is not a dating site. It's just a way to interact and connect with people. And I think that She's connecting with the J-Dubs because it's easy. You know what? It's easy. They show up and knock. They come to you. It's almost like calling for a pizza. I'm hungry. I want a pizza. I'm going to call up Domino's, and they're going to bring me the pizza. Oh, my God. I get the large with the thin crust, you know, with lots of vegetables on it. Whew, so good. All right, I'm off the track again. So look, you call up and order a pizza. They bring it to you. You love the pizza man. You give him a dollar or two. Well, the witnesses are the same way. The pizza delivery people of religion. They bring you their lunch, the spiritual Lunchables. They sit down with you, and they stroke you, and they cuddle you emotionally, intellectually, and they chase the loneliness away. And then they also happen to, you know, go through some book, and you, in a very drone-like way, you read, you know, these canned paragraphs, and then you read the canned questions, and then you regurgitate the canned answers, and you work through their little book. You know, Scientology and their auditing and their e-meter, it's very similar, very similar. It's a form of mind control, but it comforts your mind. It strokes your mind. They come and they do it. They stroke her mind off. They get people off emotionally. It's a release. It's a catharsis. They love it. Just like the Domino's man. All right. I'm going to get off my soapbox again. So she says, I spoke to my Jehovah's Witness daughter after talking to you, and this is what she said. Bless her daughter. Her daughter loves her mom. And this is what she said, quote, if he doesn't like the witnesses so much, then why does he feel the need to dedicate so much time talking about them? If he really had a life, he would be out there living his life instead of talking bad about others. You know what I'm channeling right now? End quote. I'm channeling J.W. Fairytale. Dude, a lot of people like you. A lot of people are a fan of your stuff, and that would include me as well. J.W. Fairytale, he cares too. Yeah. So, yeah, get a life, right? That's their answer. That's the short version. Get busy living or get busy dying, all right? That's what Morgan Freeman said in Shawshank. If he really had a life, he'd be out there living them instead of talking bad about others. And then she also said, quote, don't talk to those people, Mama. They are bitter. And I think they have mental problems. Yeah, mentally diseased, right? We heard that one a few times. I think they have mental problems to be holding on to such hatred for so long. End quote. And Rose says, I couldn't have said it better. So see, I can be a jerk too. Now goodbye to you for good! Exclamation point. Okay, so interaction number 3 or 4 here, basically, Rose has told me off. She has given me my comeuppance, and she has verbally spanked my bottom. She has verbally spanked my bottom. And we had such a civil conversation via text, but you know, the pendulum has swung back the other way. Rose, you know, is upset, and her feelings are her feelings. And now I got to hop back over to my text app because, look, messaging through YouTube is just so lame. So lame. And, you know, I actually talked to my computer programmer friend at YouTube, and he told me the reason why YouTube messaging is so lame. And he says to me, you know, Google invented Gmail, which is probably the best or one of the best email clients that you could ever use. It's fantastic. It's bulletproof. The security, the convenience of it. Gmail is awesome. Everybody knows it is. He says, you would think that the people that invented Gmail could make a better way to message through YouTube, ... And then he told me some things that are kind of confidential, and I'll go into it. You know, maybe I'll go into it in some other time, in some other venue. I'm off the track again. So, because YouTube messaging is so clunky and inconvenient, At least for me, I know other people have said the same. If you punch it into the forums, you'll find a lot of people that are confused about YouTube messaging and the fake inbox and all that. So I just texted her back one final message, which I, you know, did not get a response to, and I'm glad, because I'm pretty much done, you know, with this one. I just got your YouTube message, Rose. Your hostility towards me is puzzling. I took time out of my day to message with you in an effort to help, nothing more. I was a servant and then an elder for a couple of decades, and I know the organization inside and out. I was only trying to help. I don't know who you are referring to in the video you mentioned. It certainly wasn't me. I wish you the best. I never suggested you go to a dating site. Meetup.com is not a dating site at all. I'll reiterate. Perhaps you could reread my texts on that if you like. If going back to the witnesses makes you happy, then do it, Rose. I really do wish you well. Your daughter loves you, and I'm glad for that. If you decide to leave the JW Truth, though, be prepared for the shunning, which is a human rights violation and quite cruel. So, I guess I got one last little dig in there because I wanted to, you know. But I tried to stay gracious. I think that's a lovely quality. I think we could all, you know, like, make a National Gracious Day or World Graciousness Day. I think it would enhance the planet if we did, even one day out of the year, focus on being gracious and thankful. But so look, I'm thankful for what I have. I'm thankful for the things that I've been able to stuff and cram into my brain in the last, you know, few decades that I've lived here on planet Earth, and especially the last 5 years that I have been mentally free of the cult of Watchtower, mentally free from the suppressive, you know, people and the narrow-minded thinking of ones that think all gay people are going to die and get burnt up at Armageddon and, you know, and on and on and on and on and on. So this has been a long one, a long email share. Give me your feedback, you know. Don't be too hard on Rose. Look, people are going to put in the comments what a, you know, blankety blank Rose Olives is. I would ask that you not do that. If you just can't help yourself, you know, go ahead. And if it's particularly mean, I'll probably just delete it, you know, because I don't want my channel to be loaded with mean things. You know, I don't. If you want to be really mean, you know, I would ask that you just go to a different, no, I was going to say go post it on a different channel. Don't do that either. Go to the lake or the ocean or the top of a mountain and just yell and cuss and scream. You know, cuss words can be very, very therapeutic in that way. They are the salt and pepper of our speech. And sometimes, this is just something, this is a truth of mine that I've learned in the last couple of years. Sometimes it's good to say horseshit or bullshit or whatever. So, look, if you're going to say those things, you know, just please don't say them about Rose on my channel. You know, find a way to channel your enthusiasm and your angst and your opinions. Opinions are good. You know, we all have them. And I don't think they all have to stink or smell good. You know, they can, you know, it all blends together into the beautiful giant Caesar salad of life. So have a great day, my fellow strugglers. Peace out.
The order is rapidly fading, for the time's